behalf of Dakota College of Bobbin, thank you for taking the time to be here tonight. This is a very special night. We have our Chancellor, Mark Pedrett, to be with us, to be part of our book read. And as many of you know, the book this year is The Circle by Dave Eggers. Has a lot of themes that are very interesting and appropriate with the changing technologies that we're experiencing. And so we're very fortunate that Dr. Hagrid is here. His background is actually such a perfect match for the topic that we're going to be discussing, and you're going to find out because of the special experiences and expertise that he has. So just a little bit about Dr. Hagrid. Appointed to the Chancellor's position in April of last year, so not quite a year.
No.
So going through the steep learning curve. And most recently, he was the Senior Civilian and Deputy Director for the Center for Cybersecurity Studies. So you can see that there's a really strong connection here with our topic this evening. Deputy Director at the Naval Academy, served on the Defense Science Board Study of Unmanned Systems during the summer of 2015. He's a certified naval nuclear engineer in power generation and distribution. Also served as chief engineer for a major environmental project involving the defueling of two atomic reactors. Changed from an engineering career to a career in higher education in 2005. And he's conducted research, writing about the evolution of technology, education, and changes in career in the workplace. So a lot of academic roles, just a lot of experiences in with military, and I could go on. But I think it's important because those experiences are so important. As you're going to learn with this topic, he has BS, Bachelor of Science from the U.S. Naval Academy, Master in Arts in Political Science and Economics from Oxford University, where he attended as a Rhodes Scholar, and has a PhD in History from the University of Maryland, and also served as a White House Fellow. I would say personally, in the short time that I've been here, what I have observed, it's great to work with a chancellor who asks questions about, so what is the impact on students? Because that sometimes we kind of lose sight of that at a policy level. And so I appreciate the fact that he asks those questions. He's really interested. For those of you that are students, we're fortunate to be in a system that has the kind of leadership that Dr. Hagrid provides. He's interested in the campuses. This is the second time that you've been here. Each time, very interested in what we're doing, how we're doing things, the types of experiences that we're providing for our students. So I think we're in for a treat, and with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Hagrid.
Thank you. Well, thanks for coming. It's nice to have a chance to get away from my day-to-day job, and also my wife came along with me, Anne. So she helped drive, and I reviewed some things, and then we actually go to tribal college at Stone Mountain tomorrow, too, and then we'll go our way back. But what a beautiful place, you know, up here. My dad is still farming northwest of Mandan, and of course his farm is the most beautiful place in the state, but you're a close second up here. But anyway, what a fascinating book that you all chose here. And I had dinner with Gary. Are you here, Gary? My quarter that I guess assigned this book. I gave him some suggestions for the next time around. And so what I understand is we have about till 8 o'clock. Is that right? Is that when people have to head on or whatever? Okay. So what I've got a couple slides that I can talk about this topic here a little bit, because the book, which is a wonderful book, though it could be depressing at times. You know, both my wife and I read it in detail. You know, that's what I do to books when I'm reading, just so you know. Don't do it to a library book, but I certainly wrote a lot in here, and just a lot of great questions that come to mind. But with their encouragement, I was going to give a few minutes of this brief, which has been going on now almost 10 years, because what happened in my career, I was in the Navy for about 20, 21 years, and my last job before I went on the academic path was to be the military assistant to the office of Donald Rumsfeld and Paul Wolfowitz. If some of the older people here can remember that. They were the ones who led us into the war in Iraq, and I was a military assistant there. And things began to go wrong fairly rapidly, And as I was leaving, a new admiral came in the office, assistant. He goes, you know, you've had this unique opportunity to be here and watch what people thought was a certainty about the world and have it unravel in a short year. And so you should take a stab at what went on there. And that essay, which I worked with a friend of mine who was the godfather of my middle daughter, won an honorable mention competition on theory of technology and conflict, meaning what is going on. And the argument I basically began to develop, which you'll see here, which you know, connects to this book and everything going on here, is that technology is becoming the driver of our time. There was a time when it was, you know, Protestantism versus Catholicism. Maybe it was economic models, you know, capitalism versus communism versus, you know, whatever, different ideas. There might have been a time when ethnicity drove that, right? The landing of Swedes and Norwegians and Germans and English on this continent, then in conflict with Native Americans. You know, it was a demographic thing that drove history. But the argument that I developed was really it's technology is driving history now. And people are trying to adapt to this. And the problem is it takes 18 years to grow a high school graduate and then a couple more years in college, and yet technology can change in 18 months. And so that was the undercurrent of what I was saying, is Rumsfeld, Wolfowitz, other people were beginning to confuse what they thought was problem A, but with technology racing along, with these devices racing along, things that they thought they could control, they couldn't control. And so so I'll present a basic theory of technology here. And when I've given this talk, I've asked people, you know, what theory of technology do you have? And I think I'm up to six people out of all the times I've given this brief. About six people had read some of these theories, but there actually is a body of knowledge and literature on theories of technology. And in 1958, a society called a book called Technology and Culture, and the Society of History of Technology was founded because people began going, I think this may become a driver. This may become the thing that we're dealing with. And they've been around for almost 60 years, and they've got a lot of books that have been published. So I'm going to give you a few thoughts on that. But that's what I think undergirds a lot of what's going on here, is the racing ahead of technology. And what I see that all of us are confronted with is what I call C-cubed. And what that is we have to create these technologies to stay competitive, right? I mean, when the Watt steam engine came out in 1776, if they hadn't improved on that, Britain and the United States would have left behind fairly quickly. So you had to create new technologies. But now, because of the cyber age, there is an epic battle to control these technologies, right? Digital technologies. There's an initiative which Botno is going to be part of, is a cybersecurity two-year, four-year, and doctoral programs here in our state. We're going to hope that we'll be one of the first states that has a statewide approach to controlling these technologies. And the reason the control is so crucial is it's ones and zeros. You know, it can be manipulated, whereas analog, you couldn't, right? Unless you were there to pull a handle at the Watt steam engine, you couldn't control it from a distance. So, but the one that's most relevant here, the third C here, is that we have a responsibility to civilize the technology and what it's doing. Meaning, make the good life out of it. You know what I mean? That this epic change that's engulfing us, we have to be competitive and create these technologies. Maybe these are the doctoral students in Fargo who are getting new patents and whatnot. Microsoft, I don't know, Microsoft has the second or third biggest campus in the world in North Dakota. That was Doug Burgum, Great Plains Software. What's unique about this age, cybersecurity, unlike ever before, is there is now a battle of who is in control of your bank account, the thermostat in your house, the car you're driving. We've never had this problem before, okay? We've never had this before. We had this one and this one, and this was civilized. This is what our great-grandparents dealt with, right? This was... We now have the automobile. Can you drive 80 miles an hour in the city? No, we had speed limits. Now we'll have crosswalks. You know, okay, you've got a factory. Can you just dump materials in the river? No. I mean, how many remember the Cuyamaga River, whatever it was in Cleveland back in the 70s, it burned? I mean, some people remember. I mean, for the younger people, there was actually rivers burning. And then a radical environmentalist named Richard Nixon said we need to get the EPA. So I think it was Watergate, but this is what this was about, right? This was the industrial age, getting control of this, making Pittsburgh a livable city. So anyway, when you think about what we're challenged with, I offer this, you'll get several frameworks here, fairly court order, but we have to be competitive, creative, we want young people to create new things, and Zuckerberg developed Facebook at the age of 21, you know, never even finished college, so it doesn't mean you have to be a doctoral student to do that. Huge issue now, controlling this stuff, which is responsibility from the National Guard to the federal government to, you know, creating your own company. And then this one, which is the main topic of this book, is where is this all going? Is this actually good for us? Okay? So, that's one way to think about this. This brief also will focus on two main events, and that is the rise of what we kind of saw here. Massive clouds of information. But for people who read this, the one person that was killed, what drove them to their, oh, hold on, some people have not read the book all the way through. Okay. Raise your hand if you haven't read the book all the way through yet. A couple. Is that only a spoiler alert? All right, we'll stop there, but there's another technology that's part of this brief that I call the second part of this epic change, and that is intelligent machines that move in human space, or unmanned systems, robots, right? So two major events are happening now. This cloud of information they talk about, but also, for those who haven't got through the book yet, unmanned systems will make an appearance in this book with fairly catastrophic outcomes. So this brief, I'm gonna give you some slides here, is that there are two macro events happening, the massive cloud and intelligent machines, which America looks like imported over 1 million this year alone for recreational purposes. And these two events are happening, and they all require this to continue to create things to be competitive, to control them because they're all digital, but then also what's the good life? So think of the two epic events that are happening is this massive cloud of information we've never had before, and intelligent machines, which North Dakota is on the map as probably one of the Air Force's leading places they can help try to protect airspace and our borders. And, you know, as much as we may not want unmanned systems to come, they're coming. The Russians and the Chinese are on record basically saying they're just going to build entire fleets of these. So anyway, let me back up a couple slides, and I'll flip through these real quickly so we get to talk about the book. And I've asked Jerry to wave me off if I'm going too long. So, the brief was cybersecurity was the main point here. And I just said there are two macro events happening, robotic artificial intelligent machines and a global grid of information. There's three things we have to do. This was given to the Chamber of Commerce, so you had about 35 states represented. You have to create the technology, control the technology, which is the main topic there, but then civilize this. So for those of you who want to go into law, policy, sociology, and I actually, when I gave this at Mary College, I had religious leaders. I think they have a huge role to play. The ethics of this stuff. I took it out for this Chamber of Commerce because I didn't want to offend anybody in the room. But to me, the first among all challenges right now is, can you even control this stuff? Because why would you create a technology that's going to turn on you? Do you want to create a technology that turns on you? There's lots of science fiction movies like that, right? So that is the context here. And if you like more reading, these are some of the books that I mentioned. I need to put the circle up here, actually. But these are different people who are thinking and grappling with this. And this one is one of my favorites. This is a history book. Talk about the Industrial Revolution. That our great-grandmothers and grandfathers were confronted with this, and they devoted so much energy to make the wonderful world that we do have with industrial technology. You have factories and not be poisoned. You can have millions of automobiles and not be run over. He catalogs how they grappled with all that, and the title is Civilizing the Machine. Okay? So those are just some books that you might want to consider. Okay, we already talked about this. I encourage you to have a theory of technology. We have lots of theories about religion, politics, judicial systems, right? With Scalia just dying, we have all sorts of theories about how the legal system should work now, right? But there's a whole body of knowledge on theories of technology. And I'll give you a couple theories that could help frame your thinking, okay? This is a little biographical of how I got into this. These pictures, each of them a story of when I began to realize the world was beginning to unravel and our leaders didn't understand it. And I was either at around each one of these events that were either energized by Twitter, computer systems run amok, the war, or this is my boss, Paul Wolfowitz, and I'm off to the side. This was when he almost killed in the hotel, if you know the history. He went to Iraq on a victory round. I was the guy kind of carrying his briefcase, and a missile missed his room by about 2 feet, killed and wounded 17 people. And that's when he realized, we don't know what's going on. This event was a famous event in 1987 when the Aegis cruiser shot down and killed about 300 Iranians when the computers got confused of what was happening. And this is my classmate right here from Annapolis, Mountford. My ship was a sister ship that relieved them after they were pulled out of the area because of the catastrophe. But it was really the complexity of the machines that overcome the people. He was the only officer about but the 20 in the control room that said, I think the computer's wrong. But he was just a junior officer. For you young people, speak up. So these are different things. This was the horrific thing of Abu Ghraib and what happened. It went on Twitter, it went out and just exploded into a revolution. And so these are just examples of things I witnessed, like how could they think they knew how the world was working when in fact it was not working that way, which then led me into my studies and eventually the doctoral work on technology and human adaptation. So here are three theories to think about. I've already kind of touched on this one just because it's kind of the main thing to talk about. But there is a theory of technology that if you don't get ahead of it, technology has a weird way of locking in, okay? Which means, you know, we met Jackie at dinner, and this is your aunt, is that right? Okay. You can change your mind about something like this if it's just something that you know, a style, a fashion, right? But if you make a decision about investing in technology, it has a habit of locking in or building momentum. And so the cautionary note here is if something's happening in the world of technology that we don't engage early, you may be limited later, that you may not even be able to change it later. And a favorite little example is this one. How many people have an iPhone? If you can just turn your iPhone on for a second and just start to write an email, okay? Just go to write an email so that your screen comes up like this, right? Okay, this screen. Anybody know where I'm going with this? This is one of the most famous examples of technological momentum. And that is once you make a decision about something, even though conditions may change later, saying, I don't want to do that anymore, when you start dealing with technology, investment, capital investment, networks, habits, you may not be able to change later. This keyboard we all have is called the QWERTY keyboard. Does anybody know when that locked in, momentum built in, that we now are stuck with this keyboard today? You want to take a guess? Around 1868. It was purposely sub-optimized for humans because all of us who remember typing on those old typewriters, the keys would jam. They purposely slowed it down because it was jamming. Within about 20 years, they said, hey, we've got a better machine, let's change it. They couldn't change it because of typing schools. I'm one of them taking a typing class. This is Scarscella in sophomore year. I think I got to about 12 words a minute. She said, I'll never be a typist, you know. I'll give you a passing grade. But the typing schools, the typing notebooks, the typewriter companies, we live with it today, and this is no longer a mechanical device. So that's the fun example of momentum lock-in. There's some really horrific ones I'll touch on briefly. So the point is here, as voters, educators, concerned citizens, that if you get a sense that I don't think we want to go down that road, it's better to engage earlier rather than late because it tends to lock in. The second theory about technology is a famous guy named Norbert Wiener and Claude Shannon said, you know, he was studying World War II anti-aircraft sailors. And I know the colonel's here. And I was a Navy guy, and he was going, you know what, the machine and the human begin to work together in a certain way, and what a human or an animal or a machine has to do is sense its environment, think about it, make a decision, and then act on it. And I would offer to you that technology is taking on a certain impulse that we keep extending and speeding up that process. And think about all the technologies we have to help us sense the world, right? 15th century, these were invented to help sense the world. Books help us to record information, spreadsheets to make decisions, and then think of all the things that acted on the world. Well, now, add computers, add hyperspeed computers, and this process of sensing, thinking, and acting really takes off. But it's a way to think about the things we do. And then what I've already referred to is that we are now into two macro events, not a micro revolution, but a macro event. A micro revolution would be this. How many here have flown on a propeller plane? I mean, a propeller airliner from the 60s. I flew on. Then they went to jet. That I would call micro revolution. It went a little faster. Airports got a little different. That's a micro event, okay? Going from a rotary phone to a punch phone. Micro revolution. What people are missing is that intelligent machines that move in human space has never existed by any stretch of any imagination. There's been people from Asimov on who speculated that they are now here. We haven't even begun to absorb what this means. Secondly, is the internet. The internet of things is spreading across the whole globe in ways that has never existed, and it's changing how we share data and whatnot. So these are what I call macro events, okay? And the challenge is they're happening at the same time, okay? So here's some theories to think about that if you don't act early, it can get really difficult. Think of technology helping a human impulse of doing this. And two of these events are happening at the same time. And what we're really struggling is to control that information, right? That it's not corrupted, it's not stolen, that your house doesn't blow up because someone hacks in, shuts off the pilot light, keeps the gas going, then reignites the pilot light and blows your house up. They've demonstrated this can be done, okay? We never had that problem before, okay? So these are some of the things that we're going to be dealing with. So real quickly, this is about technology, okay? If you engage early, you can change it. You wait too long, it gets much harder to change. And if it is late, there's a whole bunch of books. Langdon Winter's a famous book called Technology Out of Control, basically, autonomous technology. It's almost impossible to stop unless you have a near disaster, okay? And here are just two cases of where technology locked in and it came down to near obliteration of the Southeast United States in this crisis. For the older people know here, we got into a nuclear arms race. A lot of people didn't like it, but it began to gain momentum. It was madness. You know, for your younger people here, your older generation was engaged in madness, okay? People tried to stop it. Oppenheimer stopped working on the bomb. Senator, he's got famous scholarships around the world now from Arkansas. What is that? Fulbright. You know, this is madness. People, this is madness. But it gained a logic all its own until this event, and we know now from the archives, we got within one Russian officer of a nuclear war. The archives are coming out now that the Russian policy was three officers had to turn the key simultaneously to launch a nuclear torpedo. U.S. Navy was up above dropping sounding charges, not depth charges during the Cuban Missile Crisis, but they thought they were depth charges. So two officers said, before the Americans sink us, let's shoot the nuclear bomb. One officer said, I would rather die than start a nuclear war. We should make a monument to him in South Florida. We now know that the missiles were activated in Cuba, the hydrogen bombs were activated waiting for orders. So not only would the torpedoes have gone, our bombers would have come in, the hydrogen bombs would have gone, our bombs would have gone to Russia, and it came down to one human being who stopped it. Now, within days after that crisis, Kennedy got the red phone, so he could talk right to the Russians. And within less than 6 months, they began the first treaty, which was a nuclear test ban treaty, and within 5 years, they had a thing called SALT, Strategic Arms Limitation Talk. So they realized we got so close to disaster, all the old prejudices fail away, and we're even going to talk to the communists, okay? The second one, which the younger crowd can relate to this, I'm a former nuclear engineer, Japan was going to go all nuclear. It was clean energy, they could buy the uranium and stockpile, they have no oil and coal, by the way, in Japan, they just would pay to have. A lot of people said, these are reactors, are kind of dangerous, do you really want to go there? You know, talk to the hand, we're going there, until a 9.0 scale Richter earthquake destroys only the backup power generation. The reactors were untouched. It got to the emergency power generation. One of probably 20,000 components on this whole system. They made a simple mistake. they put the generators at SEMA. We've all seen the videos, the wave came over, is all they had to have done is put one generator up on a hill. That's all they had to have done. Four reactors blown up, there's a huge swath of Japan which will never be inhabited in, you know, in our lifetime. But now the Fukushima trajectory has completely changed. So the point here is on these technologies is that unlike, you know, your choice of someone you like, or you know, you want to vote for Rubio, you want to vote for, you know, Hillary or whatever, you can change your mind in an afternoon. But when it comes to technology, it has a unique habit of what's called locking in. So with regard to the internet, when they built the internet, they all knew each other. I've actually met two of the people who built the internet, Vint Cerf and Craig Fields, and I've actually seen, you know, can I see your hands for a second? I've seen the hands that actually put the wires together. I mean, think about that. This thing that's overwhelming the world, and I've actually seen two elderly men who were there when the thing came alive. I mean, it's just in our lifetime, okay? They all knew everybody. So guess what? The system was built on trust and openness, because, you know, if Craig puts something on there, we'll call Craig going, hey, take that picture down. And now, how many people are on the internet? I mean, Craig was on the Defense Science Board with the most modest guy. I finally pieced together as a story that he was there. Vint Cerf works for Google now, and he's called the Internet Evangelist. You can't go quite, and this is being taped, isn't it? This Beyond Web? He's a very powerful guy, very generous, but it's like, you know, he was there. Craig Fields, I didn't realize until I'm like, hold it, you worked at DARPA, and were you there in 19? Were you there? I said, you were there. You were. He said, don't tell him. But they're still alive, and they all knew each other. But that is the system, back to the momentum theory, that locked in now, that we're all dealing with, right? And your granddaughter's information's on there, and your son's information, and it was built on a system that locked in, and now we're trying to backfit privacy, security, and everything else. So you wonder why we're having this trouble? They didn't understand this theory right here, which the historians came up with. An economist, but for you non-technical people, an economist came up with this theory named Paul David, when some other people were telling him, we can change any time, and he started to show you can't change. Once you lock these things in, you've made an investment for generations. So anyway, that's a theory for you to think about. This is the sensing, thinking, acting, if you think about it. Humans in the end, or in the beginning, were in charge of this whole thing, and good hunting dogs, which still are, right? Sight, hearing, taste, human decision making, the brain was the thing, computation. I mean, how many here can do long hand division? Yeah, I mean, probably a little older, but you know, I can still remember the first time my dad gave me an adding machine. Otherwise, you did it yourself. And they had this thing called a slide rule, which I never did that well on. And that was an early device, but you know, the human body did all this. Then we began to integrate machines, right? Radar, sonar helped a human understand the sensing. Then early computers helped add some things. And then we actually integrated. A human drove a car, a human drove a plane, a human drove a ship. Well, now you see where this is going. The technology sensed the environment, the computers are now making decisions, and we are getting Google driverless cars, we are getting unmanned air systems. We haven't completely automated ships because they're so big. It's not really a big deal to be a human on there. So you see that this is kind of framework, but the thing that our theorists missed again with lock-in is, again, in Claude Shannon and Norbert Wiener, they thought this was the only problem. Now, how many of the older guys here spent money as a teenager buying an amp? Anybody buy an amp for their stereo? Remember, Jerry's laughing. Teenage boys would come in going, how big's the amp? This was a fundamental reference to the mathematicians. The only challenge of this system was amplifying the signal. They never in their wildest dreams thought you could come in and corrupt the signal and change the signal. See what I mean? It just the idea that you could go in and actually change the signal and it still came in loud and clear, they missed it. And so again, locked in a whole pattern. So this is for the younger people wondering, why are we going to have such a massive problem to solve? My generation and my dad's generation got this going for you. All right. So anyway, that's just the idea that you're at a unique time. When I would tell my students this before, like one of them said, I could tell he wasn't that interested, and he said, I'm just kind of bored this week. I said, you have no idea what's happening in the world. It is more exciting than ever imagined. And Ann and I went down to Mandan bookstore. There's a bookstore called Huntington Books on Main Street. There's an elderly man there, and he's like, I'm just so glad to be alive. I'm watching history unfold right now. And my advisor, a guy named Robert Friedel, who advised me on my dissertation, he said, I remember the day when I realized I'm going to be alive when it happens. Because his whole field was the Industrial Revolution, you know, the Watt steam engine. And as a historian, he said, if only I could have been there when Watt built that engine. And he said, in 1995, I got my first email, and you know, a little melodramatic, he says, I pushed back from the chair, and I was like, it's going to happen in my lifetime. This next epic event. So for the young people here, I hope you're not bored, because you are living, you know, when the big stuff is happening. The really big stuff. All right. So what part of this theory is, it's more complicated than we even thought, because it's all combining. You're going to still have human-centered relations. You're going to still have human-machine integration, right? But you're going to have literally the emergence of intelligent machines that's going to be law and policy and restrictions and who can do what and where can it go. The problem is, as a former military guy, Europe and the United States and Japan buy into limits. Russia and China have basically said, there's no limits. So think of that, building intelligent machines, and they do not acknowledge there should be any limits of what they can do. And that's why it's good to have two Air Force bases here to help these airmen, because they are going to have a major challenge when this begins to emerge in the numbers. And a million of these alone were imported this year. So think of the problem is not just the emergence of intelligent robots, which is in the book, but also you have to still do all these other things. You have to teach and build communities. You have to have the integration of human machines. It's all happening for this generation. Now, for this book in particular, the big cloud. So the other epic thing happened is this cloud of information, this massive information. And if someone says, yeah, we've been there before, let's just think about this. This was the information machine, right? For the historians here, this was the information machine up until about this. Anybody remember when the Gutenberg printing press came out, roughly? Yeah, roughly 1500. So for 10,000 years, as long as there's been, you know, cavemen writing on the wall and people writing scribes, I mean, this is, you know, one of the most honored things in Jewish culture was the scribe, right? Because their memory, their ability to be meticulous, it was crucially important because they were recording the information of hundreds of years, okay? And it was a human, their brain, right? Writing, okay? Then the printing press came along, the movable type. And anybody in the picture recognize this information machine? Anybody know what that looks like? It's the field my dad was in when he was kind of told by his dad to get another job with him farming. Those are all vacuum tubes, okay? The first digital computer was not the iPhone. It was a thing called ENIAC, which I think was electronumeric integrated automatic calculator, something like that. It was as big as this room. And it had less power than your oldest iPhone. Big as this room. But that was digital, because it did work at the speed of light. Okay? So here was the computation, okay? The computation and recording of information. And now this is how fast it moved. Famous Western innovation, Pony Express. Okay? And believe it or not, the railroad was a massive information machine. The post offices rolled with the railroad. They had postal cars. You go to Washington, D.C., be sure you go to the Postal Museum, because they show how these cars were made. They just said, all the mail going west, dump in these cars, and while the trains moved across the United States, they had mail clerks sorting it, so they'd stop at each city. These accelerate the information from, you know, anybody here, you know, horseman, rancher, you know, I mean, how long can a horse ride before it's got to stop, water, and all the rest? The riders change out, the volume you can carry versus this, okay? And then, of course, the breakthrough was the telegraph. And for you artistic people, Morse, who developed Morse code, was an art major, basically. He was not a technical guy, he was an art guy. He was just thinking how better to represent information, okay? So this happens, and then it really takes off now. This is 1980, that was the extent of the internet, right there. And most people in this room were born not far from 1980. That was the internet. This is the beginning of the undersea cables, and now this is a 2003 representation of the internet And it's almost like a planetary or a galaxy. It goes deeper and deeper with billions and billions of nodes, all in the course of this amount of time, right? And then adding to it is the Internet of Things, that now we start adding not just colleges and server centers and desktops, but every device in your home. At the Naval Academy, we had a guy named Kevin Mandia come and give us a talk last year. And he says, you know, I think within this year, someone is going to hack and take over a refrigerator. 2 weeks later, it happened. Just, these companies are automating, connecting to the internet, and then the hackers are coming right in behind. So anyway, I think I'll probably stop there and just share with you that this book is in the context of two epic things, and nobody here should think their life will be boring. You know, down to this very limited mobility bookseller in Mandan who just revels every day watching history unfold in front of him, just thanking God he's there to be a witness to it and to talk people's ear off when they walk in there. We escaped after about 45 minutes, I think. And so it's an exciting time, but then back to these, you know, those of you working in companies or making iPhone apps, right? Keep creating stuff, creating wealth, creating new jobs for our state. For those who will be going into, you know, Jerry's cyber certificate program, you're in an epic battle of controlling this so that you can do good, right? If you can't control something, I mean, that's kind of the first thing in my mind. But then I'll stop here, that what I think the circle about is, yes, we can do these things, but should we do them that way, right? We can surveil people that way, but should we? And that really comes to the civilized part. So anyway, with that, I wanted people to participate here, because I have my opinions about the book, my wife has her opinions about the book, but I'd like people here to interact. So, did anybody here like the book? Okay. All right. Okay. This one is good. All right. How about this? Because you see, technology has made things possible that just wasn't possible before, right? How about the motto? You remember the motto? Secrets are lies. Sharing is caring. Privacy is theft. So this is the world. It's emerging. And then, for those who got through the book, there is a rule for autonomous systems, right? It leads someone to a really bad outcome. So it's a combination of the huge cloud of information, everything connected, and actually now things that move in human space to the point that, I won't say which person, but they were unable to now even get away. They couldn't even get off the grid anymore, okay? So secrets are lies, sharing is caring, privacy is theft. How many like that?
It seems like brainwashing. It seems like everybody has a belief that. Everybody has a buy-in to it.
In that company,
you
mean?
You didn't, you were wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And the company's goal was to get everybody invested in their company.
Right.
So there'd be no out.
And, gosh, we don't want to spoil the people, but there was one person who wasn't buying in, wasn't there? You finished the whole book yet? We don't want to say what, but there is one person. And for people who haven't got all the way through, it may not be who you think it is. But one person did go up against the system. And I don't want to give it away, but momentum kind of had built in that company. So secrets are lies, sharing is caring, privacy is theft. Can anybody want to defend any part of that? Because it's not, you know, it's not completely ridiculous from, if you're in a publishing company, right? You know, does our state have some pretty good open records laws?
Yes.
Someone who's living them, I'll tell you. I talk to lawyers every day. We're having a meeting. Can I do that? I'm going to call so-and-so. Can I call them, or does that have to be an official call? No. So there is some benefit. I mean, I've had people back in Maryland who said they wish they had the laws we had. They said the things that happen sometimes never get the light of day. So there is something about having a little more in the open. But that's a public official, right? I mean, I'm the chancellor, and Jerry's the leader of the school here, so you kind of want to know that when he's saying one thing about the budget, that he's not actually meeting privately with one other person, you know? But that's public officials. this is people's private lives, right? So, does anybody here think they share too much on Facebook? Is anybody on Facebook here? Anybody who's on Facebook? Okay. Has anybody had the feeling like, I probably put too much information out there? No?
I've put very little information out there, but I think it's too much.
Yeah? Like my kids, I hope they don't watch this, had their real birthdays on Facebook. I'm like, you know, when you apply for a credit card and whatnot, that's some of the identifying data. So maybe not have your real birthday. So what I did, I told Jerry this at dinner, the guys at dinner, Jackie, that I put my birthday as January 1st, 1911. I still have people wish me happy birthday. I mean, I'm just like, do I look 97? You know? I look old for my age, but Oh, you put a bogus date too in, you said?
No, I said you'd be 100, over 100.
I would be over 100, you're right, yeah. Yeah, right, there would be. Okay, bad math. Okay, you're right. Yeah, 100, maybe 106. Yeah, do I look 106? I hope. How about sharing? Just that idea of sharing. Is sharing everything, is that really caring if it's on the internet? I mean, again, it's an open question. Does that help when you see someone share something on the internet? I mean, 1.1 billion people are doing it, so it must be helping in some way, right? I mean, sharing? Yeah, go ahead. Well, defend it.
Well, I think we have some universities that offer courses online that you don't pay for. You don't get a credit, but you can get the knowledge. And that probably means good. I had a question about civilized stuff.
Okay. Yeah.
It seems to me that part of what may get in the way of civilized is efficiency. Because when we read in the circle, they are taking over voting. Now, if you think about that, what more efficient way of voting could there be than to simply check a smile on the computer? Now, isn't that totally efficient? A minute ago, Janine said, they want everybody. Well, if they have everybody, think about efficient assist. So how do you, it seems to me that efficiency is getting in the way of civilization, civilizing the machine.
Yeah, that's a wonderful point. In fact, it's nothing like going back and be a doctoral student, you know, when you think you know how the world works. And this Robert Friedel, I was doing a tutorial because I was an older student, so I literally had these one-on-one meetings with him when I was doing my work. And I said, I fell in the trap. I said, he goes, well, why do you think they built the road system that way? Well, it was more efficient. Oh. And he goes, Mark, come up to the board and write an equation for efficiency. And what efficiency is, right, is percent, it's basically an output over an input, right? That's what it is, right? How much out did you get? And that works great for a steam engine, works great for a home furnace, right? But now start to get to complex issues, right? And so quite frankly, it was a bloody tutorial because he ripped me to shreds, going, okay, so let's talk about the railroad you built. What were the inputs? Okay, well, it was a number of pieces of lumber, iron ore that went in, blah, blah, blah. He goes, how about the Chinese laborers? What was their life like? Were they treated well? How about the Native Americans? I don't know, you know, all these efficiencies. Efficiency can't capture a lot of these things, right? And I think that's what you're getting at, is if it's all about efficiency, then what about the intangible things you lose? So, well, you're supposed to defend them now. Can somebody defend them now?
What about YouTube for sharing is caring? Where you can learn how to do almost anything on YouTube. You can go on and learn how to bake tofu, and you can learn archery.
Yeah, that's it. Right.
Find a recipe for peanut butter fudge. I'm happy they did that.
Yeah. Well, I have to admit, the one thing I did back at my last job, they had a concert performance, and my wife, both daughters, my niece might have come. I had a couple students come, and we're meeting back in my office afterward. And a friend says, hey, on YouTube, they have the fireplace thing. You ever seen the fireplace thing? On YouTube, somebody has made a lot of money. She just put the camera up and filmed her fireplace for about 4 hours with the crackling. And because I have an electric fireplace, there's no crackling. And so we took the laptop, we set it up. We went to that page, we sat there having hot chocolate, sitting in my office, and it felt like it was a fireplace. It was brilliant. I mean, it gave us, you know, it gave us a lot of output of, like, it felt very cozy, you know, and everything else. And so I'm with you. There's wonderful things that are sharing there. And my daughter's on a semester down in Costa Rica, and my wife and I went on FaceTime. And we could see her real time on iPhone. I mean, it was wonderful. It helps melt the minds, you know. I was many years in the Navy, and Ann was telling me at the dinner table on my first deployment, I talked to her once in 3 months on a shortwave radio with about 30 sailors all in the room listening to me. And she goes, "I love you, Mark." And I'm like, "I love you. I can't hear you, over. I love you. I can't hear you, over." And I was like, "Just tell her what you think, you know. But you're 23 and you don't want anybody to know you're not tough." But that, our kids can't relate to that. They go, on my last deployment on a ship, I was off the coast of Iraq before the war started. I had a satellite phone. I could call every night. You know, so it is. I mean, that's it. Don't get me wrong. These are incredible technologies. The other things they're doing is rural medicine, right? They're able to share insights and diagnosis to people that otherwise patients would die, you know. Don't get me wrong. In fact, as Jerry knows, one of my major initiatives in North Dakota is, you know, unmanned systems to help the Air Force defend our borders and our country, big data to help us have control of our own data in our state so it doesn't all have to be in Silicon Valley, and then cybersecurity, you know, for the 2-year, 4-year, and the doctoral programs. So I'm not anti-technology. It's coming, and that's what this brief's about. It's coming. It is. You can't stop it, but you have to think about this. Let's see. How about, I'm trying to ask a question earlier on here. Okay, here's a question for maybe the ladies in the room. Do you like having surveillance cameras? Does it make you feel safer knowing there's surveillance cameras out? The ladies? What do you think? Does it make you, because obviously the security of women, I mean, the reality is most crimes against women are made by men. We know that, right? And so that's surveillance. So one thing, no, don't feel safe.
I don't like being watched all the time.
You don't like it?
I don't. I understand if something happens, it solves crimes, but I don't like the. And I know I just have to get used to it. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know.
Anybody here ever got a ticket from a speed camera? Yeah. We were stationed outside Washington, D.C., and I've had several assignments. I was on 5 different ships with them. I was sent back to Washington several times. It is a bizarre scene now that several times I have late meetings, you know, sometimes there's shift work at the Pentagon, and I would cut through Washington, D.C. on the way out to Annapolis. In the old days, when it was 2 in the morning, camera's rolling, isn't it? I would sometimes run through red lights because there was nobody there. It was 2 in the morning, the street is abandoned, and, you know, I'd slow up, I'd kind of stop, like, well, there's nobody here, and I'd go through it. At 2 in the morning, what are people doing in Washington, D.C.? They're sitting there idling at the intersection because the camera is watching. And it just felt bizarre. Here I am, and the other thing, this is the other thing that was non-trivial. One time my wife was downtown and she was coming back out of Washington, D.C. and got a flat tire in Washington, D.C. back when it wasn't safe. And somebody came to help her, but, you know, in those days you could do a U-turn and come to help somebody. The camera now will take a photo of you. You'll probably get a ticket. Who then is going to go down to the courthouse and try to get the judge to let you off? Because, you know, she had a flat tire, saw this lady with his baby trying to change a tire, so I did the U-turn. How many people just go, too hard? I'm just going to keep driving. I hope she can change the tire. You know what I'm saying? I mean, because you're being monitored. And I just thought about myself and went, I might even do the same thing. Do I want to pull over and then get a $45, $50 ticket? Looks like she's doing okay on the tire anyway. You know what I mean? But you see, the behavior begins to change in weird ways. I hadn't thought about that, you know? And I, you know, I got a ticket passing a slow-moving truck. The DC cameras, I accelerated to kind of keep the traffic flowing. Camera took a shot, and I had a $40 ticket. And it was like a truck lumbering along, so I accelerated. I should have passed it like 5 miles over the speed limit, right? Which then backs up the traffic even more. So a common sense solution I didn't do. So how many guys like surveillance cameras? Nobody raised their hand. Okay. Let's see. I don't know if we should, okay, so there's a question. In the circle, they build on the idea of surveillance cameras making us safer. And some of the young people in a supposed focus group suggest color coding people who commit crimes so that you always know who they are. Does anybody think that's fantastic science fiction? Because I know someone read the review in Wired magazine, which was somewhat critical of this, like, this stuff will never happen. Anybody think something like that will never happen to the color code people so they can track criminals all the time? Well, here's a thought for you. The facial recognition technology is getting so powerful, they won't need to color code people. They will be able to, if you've seen the software, basically a face is recognizable, and they basically just do this. The distance from the two pupils, the crown of the nose, the center of the mouth, and that simple mathematical measurement is pretty unique when you add the width of the face to that. You know, boom, 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 and it's pretty unique. I was at a conference at Baylor. I gave a presentation that Baylor is a Christian college originally. I think it still is, and they had faith, technology, and human flourishing. Kind of getting to this issue, like how do we allow humans to flourish in technology? They had an MIT researcher come, not to be named, and they were working on technology that could not just do facial recognition. You know, there's Jackie, there's Ann. But they could read emotion and tell if you were stressed, happy, declining happy, whatnot. And the students took her to task because the biggest buyers were consumer companies trying to sell things to you. And the idea was that if you put on your computer the software so it could watch you while you're shopping, they would give you a discount on internet access. And they would change the advertisements depending on the facial feedback. But guess who the number two largest buyer of her technology was? And this is when a bunch of students got up and they beat me to the microphone. China. The government. Think about that. We now can recognize your face. And now we can tell if you're stressed or not looking. I mean, after a billion faces, this is what a face looks like when they're angry. Why is this person saying? It's just like, that's surveillance technology that's even exceeding what they're talking about here. This is where perhaps their criticism is right, is Eggers is not a technologist, so he said, oh, people wear a red shirt or a green shirt. They don't need to do that. They are looking at actually, you know, your face, and in some countries like China, buying this technology that they actually read emotions. So think about that. If you already have someone as a target, like the Uyghurs are a minority, the Chinese are not treating well. You know, Western China is Muslim, traditional. The Chinese are brutally suppressing these people. Now you can watch them, and you can tell when they're looking stressed, and you can see people who are prone to not be supportive. I mean, it's a profiling tool on the edge. Let's see, what other questions, Ann? We made a couple questions here. Oh, okay, we're almost out of time. But anybody remember Mercer, the role of Mercer? He was kind of like the, I don't know what you call that, from your literary guys. Who is the guy? The contrarian, I guess, or whatever?
He's a liar.
Yeah. We won't say what happens to him in the end, but he's arguing back with May, and basically Anne found this quote. Paraphrase. Our minds are delicately calibrated between the known and the unknown. Our souls need the mysteries of night and the clarity of day. With the world that you are creating, there will be no time to reflect, to sleep, to cool, basically. And thought that was pretty profound. I agree with her. But wow, I think there's, that may be a major message of the book. You want to think about that? That he's arguing back to May, who wants to digitize everything, monitor everything. And so Mercer, who is a craftsman, who lives in outside the city, says, our minds are delicately calibrated between the known and the unknown. Our souls need the mysteries of night, the clarity of day. I had a funny dream last night. I often remember my dreams, but I was dreaming last night. There will be no time to reflect, to sleep, to cool off if it just keeps monitoring everything. Anybody, any thoughts on that? Is Mercer aligning with your thoughts on that? You want to disagree with them? Gary, you've been kind of quiet.
Well, to add to that,
And that was page 434, in case you're looking for it.
Monetize was another part of that. It's not part of that quote, but another element of the issue of dealing with digital technologies. It's not only that time away from it, but the people that are using technology in the circle. Everything has to turn up, has to produce some money somehow. Yeah. And they want, and then they talk about monetizing this whole, everything that they do. I was just thinking about that in relation to that quote that they, that reach of technology. And the way it meshes with capitalism.
Yeah. They're right, because if we can actually, you know, be selling you stuff while you're sleeping, that's an even better idea, right? Well, we'll give you a discount on internet access if you let us do that. And you can see how the momentum theory gets here. You see, when you kind of lock things in, you lock patterns in, you know, which is why I'm really going to push very hard for our state to invest in its own cloud computing. Because once you get addicted to computing in Silicon Valley, right? Think if we do that in 10 years from now, we say, you know, North Dakota needs to build its own computational capability. It's just so cheap now to run it out of Silicon Valley. We talked about it at dinner. If you haven't been following, but the big internet companies are beginning to assert themselves beyond the government. Just last night, they turned down the FBI trying to investigate a man and woman who killed off their Christmas party. And Apple said, no, not going to give that information. I mean, it isn't like they're just fishing for something. Like, here are two murderers who killed all these people at the Christmas party. We need to find out what they were doing. And Tim Cook of Apple has refused to give them the cryptography. Law of the land, right? The attorney general is the boss of the FBI director to the president, approved by Congress. Reasonable request. And the second thing we're talking about at dinner was Zuckerberg is now exceeding federal law on firearms. And it's basically said no one will sell any weapon on Facebook. Done. Because they're just so bad. You see, if you stop using the Postal Service, you know, like I was talking about, you know, my brother and I, you know, bought shotguns and the kids. Basically, if a kid is addicted to Facebook, the momentum is I don't write letters anymore. You know, all my computing is done in Silicon Valley because we don't have any servers here, and now Facebook has decided we can't sell a gun to my cousin in Rugby. So I'm saying that it's like, do we really want to be that dependent on someone who starts to assert values like that? All right, well, I've just gone over. Is there any questions that I can field? I'm glad to stay here afterward for a while and chat, but any question? And a recap, for all of us here, it's an crazy time to be alive. Technology, I think, is becoming the driver, lots of drivers, of course, in life, but becoming the dominant one. And we're blessed to live in a time of two macro events, intelligent machines moving into human space, and this massive cloud. And the challenge is, you know, create and be competitive, right? Create jobs and whatnot. Control these things especially so they don't run amok, which is plenty of evidence of that. I've got a slide here about 20 cases of the battle for control. Maybe that's the last slide I'll put up. And the issue here really is civilizing the machine for the good life and its metaphors. So any question while I scroll down to that last? Yeah, Jerry, go ahead.
I just wanted to say on behalf of the college, I wanted to thank you and your wife Ann for being here. I think that's demonstrated why we're really fortunate that you're the Chancellor for the North Dakota University System. Great leader and a great academic. And they were just a wonderful presentation. And I want to thank Mike Porter and Gary Albrightson, who have been the spark plugs behind our book read, and they've been instrumental in this whole process. So thank you for the work that you've been doing.
Thank you also for the memento. So much appreciate that.
And he has his Dakota College of Bottom of Diet.
I do, yeah, just so you know. There it is.
Well, thank you for
all right, thank you.